Solemnity of Corpus Christi is taken from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brethren, I have received of the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread and giving thanks, broke and said, Take ye and eat, this is my body which shall be delivered for you. Do this for the commemoration of me. In like manner also the chalice after he had supped, saying, This chalice is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you shall drink for the commemoration of me. For as often as you shall eat this bread and drink this chalice, you shall show the death of the Lord until he comes. Therefore, whoever shall eat this bread or drink of the chalice of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man prove himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of the chalice. For he that eats and drinks unworthily eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the body of the Lord. Continuation of the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time Jesus said to the multitudes of the Jews, My flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eats me, the same also shall live by me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate manna and are dead. He that eats this bread shall live forever. Announcements. I thank you for your prayers for our retreat. It was definitely a time of rest and prayer, so thank you for supporting us in prayer during our absence. Because we are back, the schedule is back to normal, so the usual masses and schedule for the week, also the divine office. However, Friday is the Feast of the Sacred Heart, so we do have a special schedule on that day, just additions. So there are the low masses as usual at 8 and 11:15. But then because we did not have First Friday Adoration, Love Adoration on the Feast of the Sacred Heart on Friday from 12 noon to 5 p.m. And then there will be a solemn mass in the evening at 7:30. So again on Friday, because it's a Feast of the Sacred Heart, we have masses as usual at 8:15, low masses. Then adoration all afternoon long, and then a solemn mass at 7:30 p.m. Also, in the back, there are shortbread cookies for sale, which Sister made for the feast day. And then lastly, we would have, of course, had, of all days, to have a solemn mass. Today would have been a fitting day to have it, but Father Lundberg at Sacred Heart, the pastor there, is still very ill, He caught COVID and he was in the hospital and may still be in the hospital. So we were asked to cover the Latin Mass at 12:30, and that's where Dom John is gone. And of course his father said he's unable to assist at the Mass as a minister, and so therefore we have to have a Missa Cantata on this day. Dearly beloved, today we celebrate the Feast of Corpus Christi, which was instituted in 1264 as a way of honoring the Blessed Sacrament with fitting devotion and worship as a separate feast in response to a miracle of Bolsena in Italy. We always celebrate as a church the institution of the Eucharist on Holy Thursday, but we never have enough time to give it precisely its due because immediately after the Mass we must think of Judas's betrayal and our Lord's arrest and begin the contemplation of his passion. But the miracle of a bleeding host in 1263 in Bolsena, Italy, became the impetus for a universal feast, especially honoring our Lord's presence in the Blessed Sacrament. There are many things that we could think about on the occasion of this feast, because it's so rich in its symbolism and its doctrine and its texts. One could read the Corpus Christi sequence many times and still it would take a lifetime to fully incorporate it. But one particularly apt consideration this year is the way in which the Blessed Sacrament shapes and determines our worship as Catholics. Over 20 centuries, the Lord's presence among us in the Eucharist has inspired and shaped our liturgies, both East and West. It has determined our architecture. It serves as an indication and a test of our piety. And it is the reason why priests exist. St. Thomas Aquinas says, if there was no Blessed Sacrament, there would be no priests. In many ways, the Blessed Sacrament is parallel to what the Ark of the Covenant was for the Jewish nation. As the center of their worship, the Ark comprised the material basis of their ritual and their ceremony. Wherever their sanctuary was, whether it was the tent in the desert or the temple that Solomon built and then was rebuilt again and again, the holiest part of the sanctuary was where the Ark was placed. That is, the Ark made it holy. And only authorized persons could enter into that part of the tent or the temple. Only the priests could handle the Ark of the Covenant when it was necessary to move it. And when it was in the Holy of Holies, only the high priest could approach it. At different times throughout the history of Israel, God descended upon the Ark in the form of a cloud to symbolize his presence among his people. The Ark of the Covenant, we know from the Book of Revelation and from the writings of the Fathers, prefigured the Blessed Virgin Mary. It was made of acacia wood, which never rots. It was covered on all sides in gold to symbolize her fullness of grace. And it housed the rod of Aaron and the manna from the desert, pointing to Christ's priesthood and his body and blood. But when God descended upon the Ark of the Covenant, who was Mary, once and for all the Annunciation, not being simply visible by a cloud now and again, but taking on our human nature to be eternally visible, the most important object of our worship was no longer the Ark of the Covenant, but it was God himself who came down to dwell among us. Although he left us bodily in his ascension, he remains with us by his choice and because of his great love for us in the Blessed Sacrament. Whatever worship and reverence was given to the Ark, all the more so should it be given to the Blessed Sacrament in a much greater degree, for it is God himself, under the appearances of bread and wine. This sacrament is deserving of a special place in the Church, of a special reverence given by all, and of a special class of men who are consecrated to its service, who are the priests. The virtue that relates to all of this is the virtue of religion, which is a special type of justice. We owe justice to everyone in that we should give others what is their due, whether it is money or labor, respect or gratitude. But to some persons we owe elevated types of justice, to God, to our country, and to our parents. And justice towards God is called religion, the virtue of religion. We owe God honor in return for all that he has given us, and that honor is given interiorly in our hearts, and then expressed outwardly by our actions, because we are body and soul. Because the Eucharist is God himself, honor is due to him in this sacrament. Inwardly, love and adoration, and outwardly, actions that correspond to the truth of the mystery and the depth of our faith and our love. The way that the Jews reverenced the Ark of the Covenant was an act of religion. They gave to the Ark, as representative of God's presence among them, a fitting response, a just response. Catholic worship is an expression of a fitting response and a just response to the Blessed Sacrament. The Lord gave us his body and blood in a very modest liturgy of a few words and a few gestures. The Church has added to that simple early rite out of love and devotion, so that we have such a thing as the Solemn Mass in the Latin Rite, with its ceremonial and its reverence, its texts and its music, an attempt which has been fine-tuned and added to over the centuries, guided by the Holy Spirit, to give the Blessed Sacrament the honor that he deserves. The virtue of religion has been at work this whole time in the Church. We know that the gift of Christ's body and blood at Mass and in the Tabernacle is so great a gift that as a Church we must be ever vigilant that we are making a just return to him. In his first letter, St. John says that we cannot say we love God whom we cannot see if we do not love our brother whom we do see and whom he dwells by grace. But we can extend this analogy and say that we cannot say we love God we cannot see if we do not love the God whom we can see. We can see God in the Blessed Sacrament. Under the appearances of bread and wine, it is true, but we can see God. So whatever worship we owe to the unseen God, we can give to the God whom we see in the Blessed Sacrament. That is the beauty of this gift that Christ gives to us. Therefore, the way that we reverence the Blessed Sacrament as a Church matters very much. And this is why, as the centuries passed, the Church increased her actions of reverence towards the Blessed Sacrament. She did not increase in reverence, she always revered the body and blood of the Lord. But external signs of reverence were increased in number and intensity as time went on. And this is because we are not Cartesians. These gestures teach us without speaking, and they either reinforce what is in our hearts or they correct what is erring in our hearts. The worship that we give to the Blessed Sacrament in obedience to the Church's mind and laws and history influences our inner love and our reverence. As St. Thomas wrote in the sequence, Docti Sacris Institutis, having been taught by these sacred rites, we better love the sacrament. We learn how to love him. If we love another human being, we show that principally by our actions. If all we do is say how much we love someone and never back it up with action, then we are shown to be lacking in love. When we love the Blessed Sacrament, we show it above all by our exterior actions. We genuflect when we come into church to honor his presence. We confess our sins often so that our hearts will be worthy of him. We kneel and receive on the tongue to acknowledge his divinity in the appearances of bread and wine. And notice how much the priest shows his love during the form of the Mass, which we celebrate. Formed, the priest is formed to do so by the Church's worship and history. He genuflects over and over again, so much so that he may lose his knees over the course of his lifetime. He holds his finger and thumb in a special way for almost half of the Mass, lest he lose a fragment of the Blessed Sacrament. And he never turns his back on the Lord once he is present on the altar after the consecration, even when he speaks to the congregation. Notice that earlier in the Mass, the priest turns around whenever he wishes to address you, but as the Mass goes on, he stops turning to speak to you because he must keep his eyes on the Blessed Sacrament until it is consumed. As Pope St. John Paul II wrote in his last encyclical before his death, there can be no danger of excess in our care for this mystery, because in this sacrament is contained the whole mystery of our salvation. There can be no danger of excess in our care for this mystery, because in this sacrament is contained the whole mystery of our salvation. Since we cannot always serve God as much as we would wish or pray as often as we would like, we should put all our energies and attention to worshiping God in the Blessed Sacrament when we have those moments given to us, to receive him reverently and carefully, to genuflect with devotion and slowly, to visit him as often as we can in the church and stay with him, and to pray especially that bishops and priests take better care of the sacrament and be pained in their consciences at abuses, and to make reparation as much as you can for the sins that are committed against his body and blood. If you know of or have witnessed abuses, it is normal to get angry at those things. That is a good sign of your piety. But then transform that anger into pain of heart, pain that wishes to make amends to God, both for sins of ignorance against the sacrament, which are so many, but also sins of malice at times against that blessed sacrament. Remember that the inner devotion that you have, the religion in your heart, your desire to make a fitting return to God, all of this finds expression in the exteriors. If you've been drawn over the past few months or many months to a greater reverence for the Blessed Sacrament because it was in it for a time taken from you, or if the intuitions that you always had have simply been confirmed by 2020, act on those convictions. Act on your knowledge. Hold fast to your principles, and be, in a way of speaking, stubborn in loving Christ's body and blood. Over against the world and over against the status quo, be stubborn in loving him. Have what St. Thomas calls an animosa fides, a courageous faith, a lively, energetic faith. Whatever abuses there are and whatever lack of faith there is in the church as a whole, we can remedy those things and bring about conversion and reform and reparation by doing our little part day by day and loving the Lord and the Blessed Sacrament as much as we should. And then never forget to pray that many bishops and priests may rise up with this same love in their hearts, willing to lay down their lives so that, as the old prayer says, the heart of Jesus in the Most Blessed Sacrament be praised, adored, and loved with grateful affection at every moment in all the tabernacles of the world, even to the end of time. Amen.
Spirit of God. Yeah. et divina institutione formati, aude eus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, venia regnum tuum, ea voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum, da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Thank you.
Confiteor Deo omnipotenti.
Beate Maria, Santa Virgine. Beato Michele Arcangelo. Beato Giovanni Battista. Santi Apostoli, Sergio e Paolo. Omnibus Sancti Sergii Pater. Quia Grandi Solicitazione.
Amen. Amen. vivis et regnas in saecula saeculorum. Blessed be God.
Blessed be God.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be his holy name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man.
Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Blessed be the name of Jesus.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most sacred heart.
Blessed be his most precious blood.
Blessed be his most precious blood.
Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar.
Blessed be Jesus in the most holy sacrament of the altar.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete.
Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy.
Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy.
Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception.
Blessed be her glorious assumption.
Blessed be her glorious assumption.
Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse.
Blessed be Saint Joseph, her most chaste spouse.
Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Blessed be God in his angels and in his saints.
Thank you. saecula saeculorum.